Hi, lovely. This is Katarina from katarinaandre.com, and I'm so excited today to be here with Peggy Oliveira, who is here with me. Hi, Peggy.
Hi, Katarina. So happy to be here.
Thank you. I'm so happy to have you here. For those of you who don't know Peggy, Peggy's a transformational healing mentor and speaker. And known as the Survivor Whisperer, she shares her expertise as a trauma therapist and her personal experience of childhood abuse to help heal the shame of sexual abuse and assault. Peggy is the founder of Courageous Journeys, and with over 15 years of experience as a psychotherapist and advocate, she weaves all of her experience in magic to support beautiful people in beautiful ways. And her deepest desire is to help women uncover our hidden wounds and heal our shame, allowing us to finally find the freedom we deserve. And I'm so excited, Peggy, to have you here, and so excited to share Peggy with you, because her mission is so beautiful and so important, and she'll share some information around that. And in addition to that, because as mothers, I really believe that healing trauma and shame and having these conversations really puts us in a better position to prevent perpetuating patterns of shame and abuse in our families and in our communities, regardless of whether we're talking about sexual abuse or, you know, physical abuse or verbal abuse or even abuse that we can feel. We don't even know where it's coming from, but we can just feel that, and we've all experienced that in some way, shape, or form. And so I'm really excited, Peggy, to have you here today with us to have this conversation about something that I really think doesn't get talked about enough. And also to say, you know, I think this is an area that we really take for granted in conversations about motherhood. Because I remember going on, you know, blogs or online looking for, you know, parenting advice around how to handle tantrums and stuff like that. And some of the advice that's dished out is, you know, it's like, it's just so matter of fact. It's like, you're the adult, just act like the adult, you know, like all these things that doesn't look at the complexity of our own wounding and our own triggers that our children might be triggering in us, our partners might be triggering in us, a friend or a coworker. And so, yes, we're grown women, but we also have this wounded part of us, and that looks different for everyone. But that was when I was really thinking, you know, these kinds of conversations we need to have too, and just recognize that there's sometimes deeper levels of things going on. So thank you so much for joining us.
I really am very happy to be here and being able to share this information with all the people who love your work. And I am one of those people. And that's why I'm really, what part of the reason that I'm so happy to do this, because I know that the work that you do is I think so meaningful and something that so many people can really benefit from. And being able to have this kind of conversation in that, I think, is so powerful. So thank you for having me.
Thank you, Peggy love. So before we jump in, I would love to have you share your story with us and just give us a little bit of background around how you even got to doing this powerful work in the world and supporting women in this beautiful way.
Sure. So as you identified in the intro, I was sexually abused growing up by three different people. And in addition to that, my mom was depressed, though she was not diagnosed. But because of that, or at least in part because of that, she was pretty neglectful as well. She was not abusive to me, but she also was not able to be the mom that I deserve, that any child deserves. And I had always known that the sexual abuse started when I was about five. That's my earliest memory. And the last time it happened, I was 15, 14 or 15, I don't remember exactly. And throughout my childhood years, I always knew that something had happened that affected me on some level, that I didn't like it and somehow it was going to have an impact. But I didn't recognize that all of the struggles that I had, the way that I felt about myself, the way that I showed up in the world, I didn't connect the dots. And it wasn't until much later on when I ended up having a really difficult day that I ended up seeking help. And that started my journey. And I remember going to a group early on, very early on in my healing, and it was a group for survivors of abuse. And it might have even been the first group night. But I remember leaving there and thinking, why don't we know this? Why isn't anybody talking about this? If we knew this, it would change everything. And I actually just connected that dot very recently, that was the beginning for me. But anyway, I started healing, and I actually started my educational training at the same time, just about, and loved social work. I fell in love with social work. I think there was a part of me that was trying to heal myself and understand myself, and just kind of ended up falling into therapy. That wasn't my intention, but I did know that I wanted to work for my local rape crisis center. They came in and did a presentation in one of my classes, and I thought, that's what I want to do. And so that really started my professional work, and where just through meeting all of these incredible, mostly women, just recognizing how no matter what the experience is, we all come away with the same struggle. We all come away with the same beliefs about who we are and how that ends up expressing itself in the world. So I started doing individual therapy in my private practice, well, actually in an agency, and then I ended up doing private practice. And just the more that I've explored after leaving my private practice, just really recognizing how much of an impact how we believe or how we believe who we are in the world affects all of us, no matter who we are, that no matter what our experience is, all of us are going to come away from our early life experiences with an idea about ourselves that isn't true, that isn't real. And that when we hold on to that, over time, it just continues to be reinforced, and it becomes an automatic instinctual belief that we carry around. And everything that we experience in our life reinforces that or is a result of that. Mm. And oftentimes there's shame at the core of who we believe that we are. So my work has kind of evolved to trying to share this message to all people. To all people, because it's something that so many people, everybody, I believe, can relate to.
Thank you, Peggy. I think that resonates with me so much. And I thought, you know, that's also why this would be such a beautiful conversation to have, because it's so relevant for everybody in some way, shape, or form.
It is, yeah.
So what I would love to hear from you is, so you said it all kind of started for you on when you had a really bad day. So I assume in hindsight, thinking about it, you know, there were plenty of signs. And so my question is, you know, we all have wounding of some sort, and we're all carrying around this belief, many false beliefs, but around who we are in the world and what you just spoke to so beautifully. So I'm just wondering, how do we know there's healing to be done in these spaces? How, and how does the absence of healing affect our lives? Just, you know, to help us think about, okay, to actually be willing to go there and explore.
Yeah, great questions. And it's literally, I could spend a couple of hours talking about this by itself. So how to, first of all, remembering that everybody comes away affected, that it's not possible to experience your childhood and early adult life and not be affected negatively in some way. Okay, even if you just think about stages of development and how our brain develops and how our sense of self develops, there's going to be things that we experience, especially for children at this time in our history, who just are inundated with so many difficult, challenging things. It has an effect because we don't have the capacity, literally, we don't have the capacity to understand it, to process it. And children innately, to some degree, are not capable of being able to really express what is really going on with them. Mm-hmm. And as parents and even educators, sometimes we're also not, you know, we don't want people, we don't want children, and even therapists can do this sometimes. We don't want to bring up things that are going to make people feel bad. Mm-hmm. And so we kind of avoid talking about certain things or asking certain things. But all that does is make that person who's struggling feel like it's not okay to talk about it. Mm. So we are all wounded in some capacity or another. As you get older and you start noticing patterns in your life that are not serving you, you know that there's things that you want in your life, but there's something that holds you back. You just don't go after it. Maybe you choose one relationship after another that isn't fulfilling, and sometimes maybe even abusive in some capacity, and that kind of abuse can look a lot of different ways. You know, not being respected even. Or maybe you're in a long-term relationship, but you feel totally unfulfilled and wonder what you're doing, or stay in it because you're afraid that nobody else will choose to be with you. Feeling really intense reactions to certain things that happen that might seem like it's a little bit of an overreaction, or not reacting at all when there's something that really warrants a reaction. And the other thing is, when something doesn't go well for you the way that you want it to, the way that you hope that it will, what do you say to yourself about that? Do you blame yourself and think that somehow it's because of you? Either you're not good enough, smart enough, worthy enough, talented enough, whatever it might be. Or do you immediately, and this isn't as common for women generally speaking, or do you immediately jump to blaming everybody else? Mm. Because that's the other side of that coin. And in a maybe more obvious way would be just recognizing that no matter what you have going on in your life that might be really great, you come back to self-doubt over and over again. Any of those things are, I think, a really big cue that there's something that needs healing. It doesn't mean there's hidden abuse. I want to make that clear. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean that there's abuse that you don't remember. It just means that there's some area in your life that is unresolved, that you need to be able to check in and see where that wound is. And sometimes being able to heal that wound doesn't take a whole lot. Sometimes just the acknowledgement of it can be a really big step in it. And then sometimes it really is patterns of things that you've experienced over and over again. And the experience doesn't have to be an outward, overt thing that somebody does to you. It can be just our interpretation of the experiences that we have. Mm. Like thinking, like if you get in a car accident, or you get a speeding ticket, or a friend doesn't call you back, or whatever, ultimately attaching a meaning to that it's because of you. Mm. She doesn't like me. God is punishing me. I shouldn't have done that again. I'm such an idiot. You know, different kinds of things. So what is the meaning that you attach to these things that happen in your life?
Thank you. And as you were saying those, all sorts of examples were coming up for me.
And that's because it really anybody can relate to some of these types of things.
And I'll share one now. I don't know if I've really shared it or not in any other forum, but one thing that comes up for me because I haven't figured out what it is when my son would have his tantrums and hit me, it was the worst. It's I don't know. I can't even describe it. It was like I just felt like broken and like disrespected, and it was just really extremely difficult for me. And I see, moms with kids having tantrums, getting whacked, and it's like, it's just a little. It's not actually super painful. And I remember I just sitting there and being like, because you try to find answers and thinking about the past and abuse and, have I ever, and just coming up with memories and, I worked through all that and there was nothing there. It's something else. I'm still, curious about it. It probably has to do with a lot of the work I've done around, women's empowerment. I literally feel it for all the women, not just myself. And all the, the intergenerational, the memory that we carry, the ancestral memory too, even if it's not our lived experience, it can feel very real. But that's just one example that comes to mind of something that you just notice, like, whoa, there's something intense going on here because of the way that it makes me feel. It's not really like a rational or logical way to, to respond to this.
Yeah, those really intense reactions are often a very big indicator that it's much deeper than what is happening in that moment for sure. And I also want to just that example that you gave, and we'll probably talk about this a little bit more. As a mom, there is so much innate shame in being a mom. I think internationally for sure, but I think in some countries, some cultures, it's a little bit more intense. But there's so much shame, and to have your child even have a tantrum in the first place can feel shameful. Certainly to have your child act out in a certain way feels shameful. And moms are often the worst at shaming other moms, and we do that as a way to feel better about our own mothering. And there's so much work, I think, to be done in that community, which is, so many women. So much work to be done there.
I love that you mentioned that. It's so true. It's so true. And I don't think we realize how bad it is until we're in the thick of it. And it's everywhere, society and the media, and it's all making us feel terrible about ourselves so that we'll buy something or fix something or go on some retreat, to get our body back.
Yeah, and surgery. My goodness.
And I'll tell you about the international thing. I do feel it. The second I land in the US, I feel it, I immediately become more self-conscious and more aware of things. Less so now because I'm just more noticing of it, but because I've traveled a lot, I've just noticed over the last 10 years when I land in the US, like, I don't know, it's like seeps into me somehow. All of a sudden, it's like, oh, must conform, must fit in, like, this is good, this isn't bad. Whereas, if I'm, I remember when I was living in London, I would go back and be like, oh, God, I can relax now. So there's definitely a cultural aspect there, and I'm sure it obviously depends also where you are in the US. I don't want to generalize, but just to acknowledge that we often take for granted, especially when you spend a lot of time in one place, that this isn't necessarily the experience of everyone. And I always see this beautiful thing on Facebook. Which fills my heart, and I've always wanted to figure out the origin of it. I don't know if you've heard of this or seen this, Peggy. It's this post that very generically references an African tribe which drives me crazy because I'm like, what African tribe? But when somebody makes a mistake in this particular culture, in this African tribe, whatever it may be, on the whole continent, that instead of shaming and punishing, and that instead what happens is that the tribe will gather and celebrate the person who made the mistake, as an acknowledgement that we're all human, we all make mistakes, and to help them feel loved and embraced in spite of it. And I love that. I think it's so beautiful because it's so the opposite of what happens, and probably 90% or more of the globe. I'm just like, who is this tribe? I want to learn more so that I can. Sure,
want
I want to go there. I'm
to
maybe they're in Southern Africa, and I'm often very close. Yeah.
I have heard something very similar to that. I don't know if it's the exact same thing. And as you talk about that, it kind of just reminds me a little bit about my drive to do this work and to speak publicly. Because, I had a private practice and that was great and I love that. But it wasn't until about a year before I left my private practice that I started speaking publicly. And I think that, you identified that that I'm kind of known as the survivor whisperer, and that isn't something I came up with. That is something that I've actually heard people have shared with me, that they're like, you're like the survivor whisperer, the dog whisperer, you're like the survivor whisperer. And I decided to own that. But I think part of why people feel that way is because when I speak, and most of that happens on YouTube, I have a YouTube channel, but I talk about really personal things. I talk about the reality of what it means to be a survivor and hold on to shame and how I personally have been affected. And when we can, as I refer to it, in terms of healing, is we have to be able to stand in our truth. And our truth is human. And perfection doesn't exist, and we're going to make mistakes. And again, an area with parenting that this can be such a powerful thing is just recognizing that nobody is perfect, that you will hurt your child. You will not be available when they want you desperately in that moment. You will say something one time, you will yell sometime because you're stressed and you don't know what to do. It's going to happen as it happens to everybody. And we need to stop pretending that, and this kind of goes to the other part of your question, we need to stop pretending that anybody can ever get to a place that they're never bothered. That nothing ever affects them, that they never take a step back, that they never are affected by something. We need to know that people are real. And real is messy, it's hard, you screw up. But what is beautiful and what is healing for the world is to own it. It's to own it. And that is so hard, particularly if you are filled with shame, because to own it, it triggers that shame. It really makes it so big in that moment that you want to push it further and further away. And that's often where judgment of other people will come in.
And what's coming to me as you say that as well is, first of all, when you say, we are going to screw up with our kids in some way, shape, or form. And part of us, when you say that, part of me cringes and is like, no. And the other part of me is like, thank God. It's that, it's both. It's not one or the other, it's both. what's coming to me as well is, the beauty in that is that it also in them having those experiences, their own personal experiences, whether it's related to us or another situation or context in their lives, is that that's an opportunity for them to learn to do the dance with shame and to also have the lesson in their life of owning it themselves. Because if there was nothing ever wrong ever, then there would be no lesson there to be learned. That's just what was coming through to me as you were saying that, as I was cringing and sigh and giving a sigh of relief at the same time.
Yeah, and even that idea that we need to strive to be somebody who is a perfect parent and will never do anything wrong, we can never live up to that. And if you think about just the everyday stress, whether it's a conscious awareness or not, but just the everyday stress of, oh my God, that we can't function, we can't show up in the world authentically if we're always afraid of not being a perfect parent. And what you said, I think, is both pieces of that we can hold both of those things at the same time. But then the other piece of that about a child experiencing certain things, I think, is important. Children, we can only control so much, and children spend much of their time away from us, and things are going to happen. And even if a child, you know, let's say something really difficult happens to a child, it's certainly going to impact them, especially in the moment. But what really determines, and this is true for people who are abused as children as well, what really determines long-term impact for any of us is when you have this experience, do you have the opportunity to speak your truth? Do you have the opportunity to say, oh my God, that was horrible, as an adult or as a kid? Mommy, mommy, you won't believe this happened to me. Like, do you have the ability, do you have the capacity to be able to say that, to share that? And if you do, and it's met with, oh, I'm sorry, or I'm here for you, or I don't know what to say, but I'm here. If it's met with compassion and empathy, if it's met with authenticity, that will do a lot for the level of long-term impact that event is going to have. And if it's something pretty minor, like a kid says something rude at school or something like that, that kid's your child is going to be okay, mm-hmm. because they know that they have safety. They know they have some place to be, that they can feel perfectly okay no matter what was said to them. And so that will have a really big impact. It lets them know that it's okay not to be ashamed of that. And it also lets them know what it looks like to hear those things, and to not run from not knowing what to do, or to run from something that's difficult. And if, as a parent, you screw up and you yell at your kid or whatever it might be, being able to go back and say, you know, I'm really sorry that I yelled at you. I was mad, but I wish I had a better way of handling it in that moment, and you did not deserve for me to yell at you, and I'm sorry. To witness, to experience somebody doing that as a child or as an adult, really. Yeah. But to experience that as a child, whatever, you know, not so great feelings that are there, it helps you realize, okay, it wasn't me. Mommy doesn't hate me. But it also gives them an example of how to own when we don't do something the way that we would really like to. So there's so much power in both of those pieces. And I think as a parent, we have to be able to own both of those sides. Like, oh no, and oh, thank God. Yeah. Yeah. So we have to be willing to stand in that. I remember hearing parents, and part of this was in my work, and I guess maybe just with other people that I knew, like, who would say, and I remember a client in particular, like, oh no, and I don't remember if her child, she was leaving her child, maybe she was divorced and her child was going to go stay with the other parent for the first time or something. Like, she was just like, oh my God, it's going to be horrible. I'm going to miss my kid. And just over and over and over again. And I knew that it was coming from a place of saying all the things that she thought she should say. Like that it wasn't, like she couldn't for a moment enjoy the peace that might come from not having to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning with that child or clean up after they throw up or, you know, whatever it might be. And I recognized in that moment with her that, why do we do this? And I never really did that. So, and I don't know why that is the case, because it wasn't necessarily that I had a lot of really healthy support or modeling done for me. But I just was like, why don't we do this? Why do we pretend? Why do we tell ourselves that we want to spend every waking moment with our child? Because if we're all honest, we don't. We need time away from our children in order to be the best parent that we can be. We need time away from our spouse in order to be the best spouse that we can be, or our partner. We need time to be at peace. We need time to not be 100% fully responsible. And so even just recognizing the shame around not being able to say, oh no, I enjoy my weekend away. Are you kidding? Not having to do that right now just feels amazing. So really that shame can come in ways that we really have no awareness of how impactful it really is.
Mm. Peggy, one of the things that you say often, I hear you say a lot, is shame is not ours. And so I just wanted to invite you to speak to that broader message, and also if maybe it's part of the message or maybe it's related to it or different, but also, okay, great, in recognizing that the shame is there, then what? Then what?
Okay, so let me address that first, that piece of that. So awareness really does go a long way. So being able to recognize, okay, there's something there. And one way to recognize, if nothing seems really obvious, one way to recognize if there's potentially some shame there or something to work on is asking yourself, is there something that I don't want people to know, or I don't want a particular person to know? How, if this person knew this about me or what I did, how would I feel? And if there's any fear, and that could be fear of judgment, fear of being hurt by that person because they're going to leave you, they're not going to like you anymore. If there's any, like, I don't know, you know, that's a really good sign that there's something there that's holding you back and holding you down. And again, it might be something that's not really, in the scheme of things, that big of a deal. And sometimes it's something that you've been holding on to that's really, really big and impactful for a long time. So that's a really good way to help you recognize. So once you recognize that, okay, there's these things there, maybe even asking yourself that question, what are the things that I don't want people to know or I'm afraid to share with people? And it doesn't have to be shared in a big public way. Although if nothing's coming to mind in smaller ways, maybe that would be a way to think about it. So you recognize that there's some stuff there. So my first recommendation would be share it. To share it with somebody that you feel that you really can trust. That maybe you've shared some other things with who you feel has supported you and doesn't look at you any differently. So that's one thing. And maybe even practice sharing it a little bit. And one of the great things that happens through that is you end up having conversations with people that they otherwise might never have, and it helps them release shame too.
Beautiful.
It really does. And so the other thing, and depending on what it is I actually really, I am a person who believes that everybody should go to therapy at some point in their life, no matter what your experience is, no matter who you are, even if you are a really great coach. Therapy is different than coaching, and therapy, even if it's just a few sessions, Therapy can help you really uncover in a different way the stuff that's really going on there and help you understand the impact that it's had on you. The other thing that I'd like to say about that, if you know that you are somebody who has experienced childhood abuse, sexual, physical, emotional neglect, and I want to just take a moment to talk about this. Neglect can look a lot of different ways. And neglect, there's been studies done about this, and this is a little bit more or a little bit newer research. Neglect actually, long term, can have as much impact as being sexually abused over and over and over again as a child. So, and again, neglect can look a lot of different ways, but if you have any of that in your history, or if you witnessed domestic violence, if you witnessed violence between your parents or a parent and somebody else, working with somebody in a therapeutic setting, or it could be a coach if they also have a therapy background, working with somebody who really has particular expertise in that area is really, really important, because it's not just about treating trauma. A lot of people treat trauma. It's not about treating trauma. It's about understanding the depth and the magnitude of what this means to your life. And if it's, just kind of more typical kinds of things that we tend to struggle with in terms of how we see ourselves, I think a coach could be helpful, helping you just kind of maybe put some things into practice, like, okay, what activities, what things can I specifically do that will help me push through this in this moment can also be helpful. Does that answer the question?
No, it totally does. I think, a big piece of it has to do with a recognition and then a willingness to receive support. And then
Yes.
the next step, which is actually, getting support.
Yeah.
I've seen breakdowns in all those areas. Part not not I don't mean breakdowns in a bad way. I just mean,
Yeah.
on that chain, sometimes we don't realize it. And then we realize it, and are we willing to actually receive support for it? And then it might be like 3 years before we actually find somebody and schedule an appointment, right? So, and then, experimenting. Maybe you need to find somebody else who feels like a better fit for you, or
Yeah.
complementary therapies. But you have to really want to receive the support and want to heal to be willing to do that, because it
Yeah.
takes time and energy as well.
It does. And thank you for saying that. And the point about you may need to try more than one person is completely valid and real. And sometimes I've worked with people who have been to more than five different therapists, or coaches before we've worked together. And I think sometimes people are afraid to move on, and you do need to do that. And the other thing that I want to say about that is sometimes that breakdown, in those different stages is often because of fear. It's often because of fear, like, I don't know if I want to get into this. But if you look at your life, there's a good chance that whether you're consciously thinking about it or dealing with it or not, it's affecting you. And the thing about healing is that, yeah, I'm not saying it's going to be easy, but when you allow yourself to do that, everything that's been affecting you throughout your life no longer will affect you. And I have never had somebody come to me and do this work and say, I wish I would have waited a few more years. In fact, the opposite almost always happens. And they say, why didn't I do this years ago? Because most people come to me in their late 30s or beyond. It's rare that I get somebody who is probably 30-ish or younger.
Interesting.
Because they just think that's who they are, that's just what their life is, it's just normal, it's just whatever, and I just need to work harder, I just need to be better, I just need to accomplish all these things, I need to get married, I need to, whatever, once all these things happen, then I'll be okay. And you can't. None of that is going to fix it. In fact, it can kind of make it worse because you think, all this has happened yet, and yet I'm still struggling.
Thank you. Thank you for also giving us that awareness in the context, in terms of, you know, the when people are more willing to seek. So, I mean, I think it's part of our, you know, emotional and personal development to go through these different phases in our lives. So I wanted to just remind you before I forget to just talk a little bit about the shame is not ours piece.
Yeah.
Because that's also so powerful too.
Thank you. So not our shame, it's hashtag not our shame.
Not our shame.
Came from kind of a brainstorming experience that I had with you among some other incredible women. Recognizing what is the most powerful piece of healing and connecting that it is the shame and ultimately the shame is not ours. And so that came from working with survivors and recognizing that all of us, whether they recognize it or not, we carry so much shame, so much shame. And the reality is that none of that shame belongs to us. There's nothing in our experience, in our coping, in how we show up in our lives, in our struggles, that we should feel ashamed of. The shame solely belongs to the person who perpetrated the abuse or assault. No ifs, ands, or buts. It's very black and white. That's it. So that's where that came from. And then over the course of this past year and a half, 2 years or so, as I've started talking with women who don't necessarily have this as part of their history, recognizing that we all carry self-doubt and shame around any number of things, is that there's really nothing to be ashamed of. The shame comes from having that moment of, I screwed up. I wish I wouldn't have done that. I should have done this. And you hold on to that because of the core beliefs that you have. And that's another thing that therapy can be really profound with, is helping you really uncover where that comes from. But it reinforces those core beliefs in that moment when you think, I shouldn't have done that. I should have done that differently. I wish I hadn't done that. Oh my God, I can't believe I did that. You know, it's those things. So we end up feeling so much shame that we're not consciously aware of. And it just happens over and over again. And it's reinforced for some people multiple times in a day. You know, if you think about how many times you have those kinds of thoughts, and it could be about work, it could be about a friendship, it could be about parenting. Parenting, it comes up all the time.
More than 5 times a day.
My children are grown and it still comes up for me. When you're a parent, you will never be able to escape that, I don't think. But just being aware of it and recognizing, okay, hold on, there's really nothing to be ashamed of here. I'm human, I'm going to make mistakes. So not our shame is being able to take a step back and think, okay, hold on, take a breath. This is not something for me to hold on to. This is not something that is proof of who I am in the world. This has no bearing on my value. And not our shame.
I love that. I want to have a t-shirt. I can wear it around my house. It reminds me of, what is that saying? Not my circus, not my monkeys.
Yeah.
Not my shame either.
Yes. Yeah. And that whole saying together could fit really well for a lot of different situations.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I haven't completed it yet, but in thinking about how kind of global this is, I have created a website. It's not complete, notourshame.com, where I will create this platform for people to be able to come and just speak our truth and be able to put things out there. I'm not suggesting necessarily that for the first time ever somebody go and share publicly that they were assaulted. They can, for sure, but it's about the little things that we hold on to every single day in our lives, to just put it out there and know that we're human and other people on that very same day have struggled with the same thing.
You know what this is reminding me of? Thank you for sharing that, Peggy. And I'll be sure to include the website. Is it live yet, or
It's not.
it's
Well,
not yet?
actually, no, I don't think it is live yet.
You're clearly on the cutting edge. I'm going to share one more thing, and then I'm going to ask you to share your existing website. So, at the very least, those who are watching can go and find you and follow you and be alerted when your new one goes live as well. This just reminded me what you were saying was today, this morning, I did a brief meditation, then I was writing in my gratitude journal, which is just one line because the failures of trying to keep gratitude journals, it's like beyond one line, it doesn't happen. And even that doesn't happen every day. But anyways, I wrote down my one line, and I have this beautiful journal, which is a multi-year journal. So I can scroll up and see what I wrote a few years ago. And the one I read this morning, I laughed so much. I was traveling somewhere with my husband and my son, and the entry was, whatever, I'm grateful for this, this, and this. Oh, and Tiago fell off the bed. Oops. This was like he was not even walking yet. So this is a baby. And I'm not going to say whether it was me or my husband or who was responsible, but I just read that and I laughed, and I was like, I need to share this. This is a great example of the kind of things that we could like go crazy and feel like terrible mothers and parents about. But I was just like, oops. I even wrote it down in my
Exactly.
gratitude journal. So
Yeah, I
that way you
love
can go
that.
on your website and be like, guess what? I dropped my baby today accidentally. He dropped himself. Nobody is to blame. We just need to put some pillows
Yeah.
next to the bed,
Yeah. And
So.
really, I know that there are many parents who can relate to that, whether a child rolls off the bed, whether we actually are holding them and like drop them or almost drop them and like grab them by their arm or
And it's because I'd heard that before, a couple stories, from friends or, seen it in some movies, like, oops, dropped the baby, that I was like, oh, wow, it does actually happen to like real people. And it's actually not a big deal because I think they're made of rubber.
Children, I think, were created with emotional and physical resilience to a large extent.
Peggy, thank you so much for joining me today and for making me laugh as you always do. Please just share with us your current website and how we can find you.
Sure. My website is courageousjourneys.com. So it's JOURNEYS.com. And also, actually, Peggy Oliveira, you can just type in my name.com. It will take you to the same place. That site is currently designed mostly with information around being a survivor of abuse. I also have a public profile on Facebook that I've just kind of started, and I'm beginning to share more just kind of general stuff as well. So that might be a place that people who might not have a history of abuse would like to connect with me there.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Peggy. It's been a pleasure as always to hear your voice. I'm so excited to have everybody else who's listening in also get to know you and your message a little bit better. And I hope you have a wonderful, wonderful day. It's evening for me, but it's still daytime for you.
It is, and the lighting is great. And thank you so much for having me. I've really enjoyed this conversation, and thank you for bringing this kind of conversation to more people. I think the more that we just hear this in so many different ways, because I'm not the only person talking about this, but I think in bringing it kind of all together, no matter what our history is, and being willing to be very transparent as well is something that needs to happen, I think, so much more. And hopefully after people hear this interview, watch this interview, hearing you talk about your own experiences, as well, like, okay, it's okay. I can relax.
Yeah, and hopefully we can also, in having these conversations, inspire others to do so as well, as
Yeah.
business owners, as leaders in organizations, and as social workers, as whatever it is that we do in the world, to just be more willing to share our stories more openly and owning them more, so that others feel more comfortable to do it, as you
Yeah,
mentioned. Yeah.
absolutely. Absolutely.
Thank you so
Yes.
much, Peggy.
Thank you.
Mwah. Bye.
Bye.